to the last step and the kind of highest up way we can approach making our personalized LLMs is actually fine tuning the model. So that means leveraging those base foundational weights that we had talked about before with some of these open source models, but then tuning it on a smaller subset of data that maybe we've prepared of question answer pairs or conversations that show the model how we want it to respond. And there's been a lot of advances with, I'm not gonna get too much in detail, but low rank adaptation, which allows us to train these large models on a smaller set of data. And instead of actually going in and training all those models again, because if you think about it, those have been trained for months on trillions of tokens, and we're only giving a handful of them. But there are new approaches to actually training a subset of weights that then interacts with that larger model and is able to change the way it responds. And we don't have to actually spend those months of training. We can train in a few a day or in a few hours, even depending on the size of the model. So this is really cool technology that we can use. And H2O has LLM Studio, which I'm going to show you, which allows us to do that really easily and has a really good interface for doing that. One other thing about fine tuning, I'd say, when we're talking about grounding the model, the prior step with adding more context, that really allows the model to have more information to grab from and give us responses. Fine tuning is not really intended for adding more information to the model. The real benefit from fine tuning is to get it to respond in a certain tone or style. So this is a tweet by Philip Singer. He's a Kaggle grandmaster who's on the H2O team. And he was talking about how fine tuning, we make the model learn to properly reply to prompts, when to stop generating new tokens and the style it replies. And he gave this really good example. So the prompt here is, what are the top three famous dishes of Austria? And you could see that the base Falcon 7 billion model, this is not trained or fine tuned to be a chat bot or to respond to question and answer prompts. You can see it has the information here. It lists the three dishes, but then it just starts going on and rambling. What is the most popular food in Austria? Austria, and then what is the national dish? It just keeps on going on and on. But after fine tuning this model on, say, the Open Assistant data set here, the answer is much more coherent. It says, here are the top three responses, and kind of lists them each out and gives you the some explanation for each. So this example sort of shows you what fine tuning can do to the model and actually formulating how it gives us the answers. All right. So these are three ways, and let's do a demo. Before I do that, what are people asking here? I'll just try to pull this over. I'm not sure if you guys can see it. Does fine tuning in this case mean instruction tuning? Yes, it can. It can. You could fine tune the model to really respond to any prompt in any way that you have data that's in the structure that you'd like it to. So let's say you wanted it to respond to a blob of text and respond with a JSON of tokens and values from within that text. You could train the LLM to do something like that. So it's not only like a Q&A, like a chatbot that it's restricted to. Let's see what this says. Many fine tuning of LLMs seem to require data input to be conversation format. Can you fine tune an LLM if you have only data that are not conversation format? Thousands of documents. Really, the approaches that I'm going to be showing you today you do need some sort of structure of the data that you'll feed the model in order to get a good response. That needs to be sort of a question answer. You need to have a prompt and a response that you expect to see. I'd say that if you have a large amount of data like that, like hundreds of thousands of PDFs, then might be a better approach to use something like h2oGPT to give it that context. All right, so let's talk about h2oGPT. As I mentioned, these products are all, they're all open source. So if you want to, you can go ahead and go to h2oGPT GitHub. This is a repository that you should be able to clone on your local machine or on a server that you have a large enough GPU and run. I'm here on a server. Let me show you here. This is my terminal, and I'm SSH'd into a fairly large machine that has some large NVIDIA RTX A6000. Now, it really is recommended that you need a GPU in order to run these locally. So if you don't have a GPU in your local machine, you can spin up an online instance that has one. But if you do have a GPU, specifically NVIDIA GPU, you should be able to do this on your own computer. So that's just to show you that. And over here, I'll just start it up from scratch. So you can see I've cloned the H2oGPT repo here. And I'm going to run this start command, which basically will just start up H2oGPT using the Llama 2 13 billion parameter model. Now you have the ability to pick from a bunch of different open source models when you do this. And like I said, this changes all the time. So there may be new models coming out and they'll be incorporated in here. So as I load this up, I can go to my browser onto the port where I have it running. And this, once it's done loading up, which it is, this actually is H2oGPT running on that machine. So I can ask it something like, write a poem about robots. And there it goes. It's running completely on that machine, not reaching out to the internet at all. Very cool how powerful it is just out of the box. If you want to just test this out and you don't want to actually go through the process of installing it locally, you can go to gpt.h2o.ai, and that will bring you to a hosted version that we already have of this exact same interface. And actually, by default, it'll load up all the models or a bunch of models that you have, and you can ask it a question. Let's ask it that same question. And it will respond, have each of these models respond. And you can turn them on and off as you'd like. But the real power with h2oGPT is the fact that we can do that grounding that we talked about earlier, where we let it use our information, our data, in formulating its response. So as an example, let me just refresh this. Let's say that we wanted to ask h2oGPT, and specifically one of these Llama models, tell me about pizza sales in 2022. Now it's responding and it's being honest here. It's saying, I apologize, but I'm a large language model. I don't have access to real-time data. And like we talked about on that spectrum of retrieval-based or memory-based, since this model is all memory-based, it's only gonna be able to give us information on what it's trained on, and it doesn't have information going through 2022. Now, the cool thing here is I found this this website about pizza sales, and it does have up-to-date information about pizza sales in 2022. So we can actually upload this document. You could also just link a URL directly, or if you wanted to, you could link it to a database. And this is going to actually vectorize this information into a vector database. And you'll see the differences when we ask it a question. It's here. All right, so I'm gonna upload this HTML version of this article's page. And you can see here it's loading it, it's chunking it and putting it into a vectorized database. And now if I ask it the same question, see the questions down here. Now it's responding and giving us the response based on the information that we provided it. And the nice part about this is not only has it given us up-to-date information because we've provided it that additional context to ground it, but we now get links to sources. So if we had 50 documents that we have in this vector database, it'll show us exactly where it went to pull this information. So you could see like it's linking to this document that we've provided it, and it's done summarization on that document. So very cool. Keep in mind, this is limited to only a certain number of documents. So it needs to fit within the context window of the model. But we also have, H2O has some other products that we offer as a service that can handle even larger amounts of data when you give it. So at minimum, I'd suggest you all go to gpt.h2o.ai, check this out, give it a try, upload some files. And then also you can try installing it locally and seeing how it runs. All right, I haven't really been looking at which vector databases are supported. That's a great question. The nice part about that is though, so this is a question that was asked by Raja, which vector databases are supported. You can actually look at all the source code and see how h2oGPT works. You can, if you want to add support for a new database, you can do a pull request on this. So yeah, everything's completely transparent here if you want to see how it works. All right, so then